بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
Honorable and respected, dear and esteemed listeners, prior to the advent of Islam, it was the practice, the custom, and the ritual of the polytheists of Arabia to have an idol each in every room of every house. And what they would do is they would embellish and decorate this idol of theirs. They would apply the most exclusive and expensive perfumes. And in this manner, they would revere and honor this idol. So there was an individual in Madinatul Munawwara who was a polytheist and who practiced exactly the same like his peers. This individual, an old, aged, frail man who was in his early 60s, Amr ibn al-Jamuh. He was a crippled man who had one lame leg. Amr ibn al-Jamuh was a very well-known, famous, and prominent member of the society of Medina. Amr ibn al-Jamuh was the leader of his tribe. He was a dignified and noble individual. Amr ibn al-Jamuh, like was the custom and the ritual of the other polytheists of Arabia at that time, Amr ibn al-Jamuh had his own exclusive idol that he would worship daily, nay, even a few times during the day. Amr ibn al-Jamuh would decorate and embellish his exclusive idol. He would adorn it with the most immaculate of clothing and apply the most exclusive brands of perfume. Daily, his first practice in the morning when he wakes up was to present himself in front of his idol, honor it, venerate it, and pray to it. And so was the practice at night before he would retire to bed. It was around this time in Madinatul Munawwara when the master of both the worlds, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, alayhi salawatu min Allahi wa taslimat, had sent from Makkatul Mukarramah a companion of his, Mus'ab ibn Umayr, may Allah be pleased with him, to Madinatul Munawwara to invite the community of Madinatul Munawwara to Islam, and those who accept the message of Mus'ab ibn Umayr to educate them with regards to the sciences of Islam. The old Amr ibn al-Jamuh, who was adamant on worshipping his idol, had a wife by the name of Hind and three young, handsome children, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, and Khallad. When Mus'ab ibn Umayr was in Madinatul Munawwara, may Allah be pleased with him, he left no stone unturned in inviting the people of Madinatul Munawwara. His invitation had such a profound effect that it entered not just every home, but it entered every room of every house in Madinatul Munawwara. Amr ibn al-Jamuh, as adamant as he was on worshipping his idol, beneath his own nose, under his own thumb, his three young children, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, and Khallad, entered the beautiful faith of Islam at the hands of the young Mus'ab ibn Umayr, may Allah be pleased with him. Not just the three kids of Amr ibn al-Jamuh, his own spouse, Hind, accepts Islam and enters this beautiful, pure religion of Islam at the hands of the very same Mus'ab ibn Umayr, may Allah be pleased with him. It was at this time in Madinatul Munawwara when Islam was the talk of the town. Every person on every street spoke about Islam, spoke about this new, excellent religion of Islam. Amr ibn al-Jamuh feared Islam being accepted by his family, especially by his three kids, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, and Khallad. So Amr ibn al-Jamuh would often say to his wife Hind that I want you to keep an eye on our three children. Do not allow them to communicate with Mus'ab ibn Umayr, because if they do communicate with Mus'ab ibn Umayr, then they will eventually accept the message of Mus'ab ibn Umayr. Least did Amr ibn al-Jamuh know that his very own three children, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, and Khallad, were not just Muslims. They were the best of Muslims at that time, despite their young ages. However, on the contrary, the wife of Amr ibn al-Jamuh, Hind, just as her husband, Amr ibn al-Jamuh, feared his children accepting Islam, Hind, because she already accepted Islam, she feared over her beloved husband that if he passes away from this world in the state of disbelief and polytheism, then he has no abode other than the burning fire of hell. So she tries her limited means to invite her beloved husband, Amr ibn al-Jamuh. However, since she admired and revered him so much, she was afraid of being specific and emphatic in her invitation of Amr ibn al-Jamuh to Islam. The children Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, and Khallad, may Allah be pleased with them all, they were not satisfied at their entry into this religion of Islam and the acceptance of their mother. They were eager and yearning for the day when they would see the father Amr ibn al-Jamuh as a faithful, loyal, and dignified Muslim. So they sit down one day, the three young kids, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, and Khallad, may Allah be pleased with them all. They sit down one day behind closed doors and they decide amongst themselves. They invite another young friend of theirs, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the famous companion of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was young at that time, the same age as the three kids of Amr ibn al-Jamuh. So the three sons of Amr ibn al-Jamuh, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, Khallad, and the fourth friend, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, sit behind closed doors one day and they decide on how to invite the father Amr ibn al-Jamuh to Islam. So they all leave the room unanimous on one point, that our father venerates and admires his idol. His idol has a very special area and place in his heart. So the only way we would be able to communicate to our father and invite him to Islam is through that idol. So the kids, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, Khallad, as well as Mu'adh ibn Jabal, one night after the father, Amr ibn al-Jamuh, resides to bed, the kids make their way to the room wherein the idol was kept. They remove the idol from the shelf and they leave the house tiptoeing, making sure that there is no one aware of their movements. The four kids, as young as they were, and we know how our kids are today, So these kids, they take this idol and they fling it into a hole where the area would dump their rubbish and their dirt. The next morning, the father Amr ibn al-Jamuh, when he wakes up, as was his practice and custom, he would go to his idol early in the morning to pray. When he enters the room, to his shock, he sees there is everything in the room except his idol. So Amr ibn al-Jamuh becomes enraged and furious. He asks if anyone knows. There is no one to reply. Amr ibn al-Jamuh is very sad. He is distressed. He is displeased. He leaves his house angry and enraged in search of his idol. He finds his idol dumped in the hole together with the garbage and dirt. Amr ibn al-Jamuh, as old as he was, with his hunched back, he bends down his lame leg. He takes support on his leg that was fine and able, and he picks up this idol of his. He cleans it, he washes it, he applies exclusive perfume, and then he places it once again on the shelf. On the same day, that afternoon, one of the sons, Mu'adh, he approaches the father Amr ibn al-Jamuh and he says to his father, "O my beloved father, have you heard of the speech and the message that is conveyed by the young Mus'ab ibn Umayr?" The father says, "Wayhak, hal sabat?" That, "O my son, woe be unto you. Have you left worshipping idols? Have you denounced our religion and accepted the religion of this young Mus'ab ibn Umayr?" The young Mu'adh negates what the father says, and Mu'adh says to the father that, "Oh my father, I have not entered into the faith of Islam. However, I have met Mus'ab ibn Umayr and I am familiar with what he speaks about." So Amr ibn al-Jamuh says to Mu'adh, "O my young Mu'adh, have you memorized any of his statements?" So Mu'adh says, "Yes, O my father." Amr ibn al-Jamuh responds that, "O my son Mu'adh, why don't you recite some verses and mention some statements of his to me?" Mu'adh commences with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين." As soon as these verses reached the ears of the old father Amr ibn al-Jamuh, he exclaims, "ما أحسن هذا الكلام وما أجمله أو كل كلامه مثل هذا." That, "Oh my son Mu'adh, such beautiful are the verses that are uttered by this young man. How outstanding and excellent are they. Is every statement of his the same?" Mu'adh seizes this opportunity and says to his father, وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْ هَذَا يَا أَبَتَاهُ "Oh my father, his speech is much more remarkable than this. Every second verse that he says is more splendid and more excellent than the previous one." The father pauses for a while and then he says to his son Mu'adh that, "Oh Mu'adh, if you want me to accept the religion of Mus'ab ibn Umayr, then I will have to first consult with my idol." So Mu'adh leaves his father. The old Amr ibn al-Jamuh returns to his idol. He greets his idol, stands in front of his idol in a dignified and an appropriate manner, with respect, as a devout worshipper. And then he begins speaking to the idol by saying that, "Oh my beloved idol, you are well aware that there is this young Mus'ab ibn Umair in Madinatul Munawwara, in our city and our community, and he intends converting our children, not just our children, the old, the young, the men and the women of Madinatul Munawwara to his religion, Islam. What is your input? What do you say about this religion, Islam?" After all, this was an idol made out of marble or stone. Is it ever possible for an idol to speak? Amr ibn al-Jamuh remains silent, waiting for an answer. However, he receives no answer. With tears rolling down his eyes, Amr ibn al-Jamuh once again addresses his idol, "لَعَلَّكَ قَدْ غَضِبْتْ وَأَنَا لَمْ أَصْنَعْ شَيْئًا يُؤْذِيكَ بَعْدُ." That, "Oh, idol of mine, it seems as though you are angry and upset with me. However, I have not done anything that upsets and angers you. وَلَكِنْ لَا بَأْسْ فَسَأَتْرُكُكَ أَيَّامًا." I would leave you for a few days until your anger subsides. The children of Amr ibn al-Jamuh, Mu'adh, Mu'awwadh, and Khallad were not satisfied at this movement of their father Amr ibn al-Jamuh. So they decide once more. And in this creative idea and opinion of theirs, they once again make their appearance in front of this idol. They snatch the idol from the shelf and off out of the house once again. This time, instead of throwing the idol into a hole that is full of rubbish, they take the idol to a well, a deserted well that was ruined nearby. They tie this idol of Amr ibn al-Jamuh to the dead corpse of a dog with a rope, and then they fling and toss this idol into the depths of this well. They return home once again as though nothing occurred. The next morning, when Amr ibn al-Jamuh wakes up, he searches for his idol. "وَيْلَكُمْ مَنْ عَدَى عَلَىٰ إِلَٰهِنَا هَذِهِ اللَّيْلَةِ." That woe be unto everyone. What has happened to my idol once again? This invited disaster and distress in the life of Amr ibn al-Jamuh. He was very fond of his idol, and now his idol has disappeared. Once again, Amr ibn al-Jamuh leaves the house in search for his idol. He searches up the street, down the streets, here, there, however, of no avail. He makes his way to this deserted well of the community, and he sees what his eyes could not believe. He sees his idol tied with the dead corpse of a dog, Amr ibn al-Jamuh, with a heartbroken emotions of his. He bends down, he picks up this idol of his, he unties the idol, and then he cleans it once again. With tears in his eyes, he returns home. He places his idol once again on the shelf. This time around, Amr ibn al-Jamuh thinks of a brighter idea. He unsheathes his sword, removes the cover, and then hangs it on this idol. And then he speaks to his idol, and he says to his idol that, "I cannot stand with you the whole night. I cannot accompany you. If you have the ability and the strength to protect and defend yourself, then here is the sword that I am hanging around your neck. Do so, protect and defend yourself." But after all, it was an idol that was made out of stone, an inanimate object. Leave alone speaking, leave alone defending. This was something that had no life in it. I came across an amazing quotation in the marginal notes of Tafsir al-Jalalain. فَإِنَّ مَنْ لَا يَدْفَعُ عَنْ رَأْسِهِ الْفَأْسَ كَيْفَ يَدْفَعُ عَنْ عَابِدِهِ الْبَأْسَ. This was with reference to the incident of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, when Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam placed an axe on an idol. So the commentators say that that idol that has no power and strength to remove an axe or a sword, as in the case of Amr ibn al-Jamuh, كَيْفَ يَدْفَعُ عَنْ عَابِدِهِ الْبَأْسَ. How does it then have the ability and the strength to remove calamities and atrocities from the lives of its worshippers? Nevertheless, Amr ibn al-Jamuh was tested in this manner by his own children. This was an invitation to Islam by his children. Mu'adh, Mu'awadh and Khallad, may Allah be pleased with them all. The next morning, Amr ibn al-Jamuh wakes up. He sees his idol is not there. This time, he goes back to the well. He sees his idol with the sword next to it, laying in this dilapidated, ruined well. This time round, he is assured that this is an inanimate object that does not have the ability of harming nor benefiting. And then he sings a few couplets in the Arabic language, one line of which is, وَاللَّهِ لَوْ كُنْتَ إِلَهًا لَمْ تَكُنْ أَنْتَ وَكَلْبٌ وَسْطَ بِئْرٍ فِي قَرَنْ. That, O idol of minds, I swear by Allah that if you were an idol, if you were deserving of worship, then you would have not been in this pitiful condition of yours. Hence I understand that you are just an inanimate object that was created by me. You have no unique powers in you. I believe in one Allah. He accepts the message of Islam at the hands of his three young kids, Mu'adh, Mu'awadh and Khallad. May Allah be pleased with the three kids as well as the father. There was a time in the life of Amr ibn al-Jamuh when he was the worshipper of an inanimate object. However, now Amr ibn al-Jamuh becomes the worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah be pleased with Amr ibn al-Jamuh. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrates to Madinatul Munawwara. Amr ibn al-Jamuh makes his appearance in the presence of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He places his hands in the hands of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now this old, hunch, weak Amr ibn al-Jamuh becomes the loyal and the sincere, diligent companion of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Amr ibn al-Jamuh remains in the service of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. During the famous second battle of Islam, the battle of Uhud, Amr ibn al-Jamuh sees his three young kids, Mu'adh, Mu'awadh and Khallad, preparing to take part in this battle. Young little kids of his, he becomes green with envy. Tears rolls down his eyes. He thinks to himself that, oh Allah, if I was as energetic and as strong as these three young kids of mine, then I would have been preparing with them as well for this battle, eventually becoming a martyr and earning the great rewards that have been promised by Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam and yourself, oh Allah. Amr ibn al-Jamuh then begins preparing to take part in this battle. As crippled as he was, as old as Amr ibn al-Jamuh was, he had a lame foot. However, this does not prevent him from taking part in this virtuous and noble act and worship of Islam. When the young kids Mu'adh, Mu'awadh and Khallad see the father Amr ibn al-Jamuh preparing, they say to the father that, oh, our beloved father Amr ibn al-Jamuh, you are old, not just old, you are crippled, you are weak, you are feeble, you have been excused. You will not be reprimanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nor by his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for not taking part in the battle of Uhud. You have been excused. Amr ibn al-Jamuh, with a cracked voice, reprimands and rebukes his children by saying to them that you are preventing me from becoming a martyr. I want to meet my Lord. I want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amr ibn al-Jamuh comes to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam holding his three children in his hand, and he says to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Nabi Allah, O the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these children of mine, inna abna'i ha'ula yuridun an yahbisuni an hadha al-khayr wa hum yatadarra'un bi anni a'raj, wallahi inni la'arju an ata'a bi'arjati hadhihi al-jannata. That O the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these children of mine, they are trying to prevent me from taking part in this battle. They provide the excuse that I am crippled, I am lame, and I am old. O the Messenger of Allah, I intend walking in paradise with this lame foot of mine. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to the kids, Da'uh, leave the old father of yours. لعل الله عز وجل يرزقه الشهادة. It is possible, and I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him martyrdom. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the kids allowed Amr ibn al-Jamuh to take part in the battle. It is a lengthy incident. Amr ibn al-Jamuh, when the battle commences, Amr ibn al-Jamuh is seen in the first and the front lines of the battle. He throws himself in the thick of the enemy, walking and limping with this crippled leg of his. Amr ibn al-Jamuh is granted his heart's desire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts his desire, because Amr ibn al-Jamuh, when he leaves home, as he was walking to the battlefield, he lifts his hands, he gazes to the sky, he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma rzuqni shahada wa la taruddani ila ahli khaiba. O Allah, grant me martyrdom. O Allah, grant me this honor and this virtue of martyrdom. Wa la taruddani ila ahli khaiba. O Allah, do not return, do not allow me to return home. Allow my body to be accepted by the Mount Uhud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts the prayer of Amr ibn al-Jamuh. Amr ibn al-Jamuh falls as a martyr during the battle of Uhud. After the battle of Uhud, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stands at the bodies of the martyrs of Uhud. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, خَلُّوهُم بِدِمَائِهِمْ وَجِرَاحِهِمْ فَأَنَا الشَّهِيدُ عَلَيْهِمْ. That do not wash the bodies of these martyrs. Bury them with the blood on their bodies and their wounds. On the day of Qiyamah, I will stand next to these martyrs and I will intercede on their behalf. I will say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that these are those sacred souls that have given their lives, they have given their wealth in your path. Oh Allah, they deserve nothing but paradise. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then says, ما من مسلم يكلم في سبيل الله إلا جاء يوم القيامة يسيل دما اللون كلون الزعفران والريح كريح المسك. That there is not a single individual who is wounded in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who stands to defend the cause of Islam, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the statements of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this pure, pristine religion of Islam, and he is wounded in the process, except that he will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah. Blood will be flowing from every wound of his. اللَّوْنُ كَلَوْنِ الزَّعْفَرَانِ. His color will be the color of saffron. وَالْرِيحُ كَرِيحِ الْمِسْكِ. However, he will be smelling like musk. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then buries Amr ibn al-Jamuh with his own blessed hands. And then he throws soil on the body of Amr ibn al-Jamuh. After a while, with tears rolling down the eyes of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to the people around him, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ إِنَّ مِنْكُمْ لَمَنْ لَوْ أَقْسَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَأَبَرَّهُ مِنْهُمْ عَمْرُ بْنُ الْجَمُوحِ وَلَقَدْ رَأَيْتُهُ يَطَأُ فِي الْجَنَّةِ بِعَرْجَتِهِ. That I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in whose control, in whose power is my life, there are certain people from amongst you, if they take an oath on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they swear, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will exonerate and absolve these individuals of their oath. And from amongst these people is Amr ibn al-Jamuh. I swear by Allah, I seen with my own eyes Amr ibn al-Jamuh walking with his lame and crippled foot in the gardens of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the martyrdom of Amr ibn al-Jamuh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the endeavors of his three kids, Mu'adh, Mu'awadh, and Khalad, in their inviting the old father Amr ibn al-Jamuh towards Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect us on the day of Qiyamah with this loyal, faithful, and sincere companion of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Amr ibn al-Jamuh. Ameen. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.